Okay, so going back to reionization, but a little bit different perspective and more gory detail occasionally. So this is was covered by Paul this morning quite a bit. So it's done with a number of different people, including several here actually. Gustavo Yep is also in the, some of the project and other people. So what we are interested in, the main problem we are interested in is essentially what happens between the, after the Big Bang, cosmic dark ages, all the way to the final ionization. So when the first stars form and they start ionizing the intergalactic medium around them, and then how this process works, what is driving it, what is the time scale, sizes, and what are the observational characteristics that will help us understand this. And I'll also talk a little bit about later large-scale structure and some other projects that are related. And that's just a different rendering, which actually is a lot more realistic than the other one, even though it's still a cartoon. Okay, so what the ionization process looks like in a actually not very high-quality movie, but still, essentially what you have is this volume in which the first stars appear. Right now it's full of neutral hydrogen, that's why it's not so transparent. And then when the first stars appear, it starts looking a little bit like Swiss cheese, eaten from the inside. And eventually all the hydrogen disappears and you get these big holes which grow and grow until it's all gone. And what we are trying to understand is basically what is how this process proceeds and what are its characteristics and how we can learn something about the early universe from that. Okay, so now it's look a lot more like cheese. Might be going bad, but okay. Okay, so what are the science drivers? Since this is this kind of meeting, I shouldn't be talking only about science, but also I was asked to talk about this. Okay, so first of all, in terms of the dark ages and ionization, which is our area, there are several things that make things complicated, like in all areas, but obviously there are specific features as well. So first of all, the physics is quite complex. And although it's not, it's mostly understood in the general sense, I mean, it's a well-known physics, it's not like the dark energy where we don't know what it is or anything. Here it's basically understood mostly physics, but it's all so complicated and so coupled together that it's very difficult to actually know what's going on. And the range of scale is huge, I'll talk more about this in a moment. There is also urgent need because there are a number of large experiments. LOFAR was already mentioned. There are other experiments, others coming up. And they also have their own massive data storage and computing needs, but also need input from us for the interpretation of the experiments. And so this is something that we need to do and we are doing at the moment. And then, as I said, basic physics is mostly understood, but you cannot just put it in, run it once, and you are done. Just because you don't know the details, you don't know the parameters, you don't know star formation, how it formed, when it happened, and everything else. So basically what you need to do is suites of simulations. So again, back to doing many simulations, but at the same time they are rather expensive, so it's tricky business. And then this is easily a petascale problem. In fact, we are already using petascale machines quite a bit. Single simulations could easily be in the millions to tens of millions CPU hours. If you, and you can scale them up very easily if you, somebody gave you the time, but that doesn't always happen. And the fully coupled simulations, which we are not quite there yet, including all the physics and all the scales and so on, well, first of all, it's impossible for all the scales, but even if you limit the dynamic range and exclude some physics, it's still difficult to do, and there are not that many, and they are not that parallel, generally speaking. Then, large-scale structure, which is a separate problem involving, it's included here, but also it's more general for later time surveys, etc. Well, it has its own problems. this is the era of precision cosmology. We already talked about this, many large surveys. Again, you need large volumes, large dynamic range. Physics becomes important. This was mentioned quite a bit already. Pure N-body is not that computationally intensive, again mentioned already, but huge data sizes, and because of the precision requirements, they are still quite expensive and difficult to handle. So it's definitely not a trivial problem even by itself, let alone adding additional physics. So what we do is basically, Paul explained it, I won't go into too much detail, but we couple at the moment, it's not fully coupled, we just run very large N-body simulations, currently up to 330 billion particles running at the moment. We get all the information about the halos, density, hail catalogs, and this kind of simulation we can scale up to 27 plus 1,000 cores, so they are of petascale size. And then we run on top of this radiative transfer non-equilibrium chemistry, and this again scales up to tens of thousands of cores, 40,000 and above in many cases. Volumes usually are at least 100 megaparsecs, and I'll try to explain why you need actually much larger volumes. And so we are now shooting for more like several hundred megaparsecs, up to 500. And you save a lot of information, millions of halos, and you need to be able to handle all this and do the simulations in some sensible amount of time. So this is how the code scale, and actually we have more data, but this is for the moment what I have to show. And this is scaling on Curie, for example, the N-body. And up to a certain point, it scales basically perfectly. Beyond that, it's a little bit off, but basically it runs up to at least tens of thousands of cores, and then there could be some issues for large FFTs and all sorts of other things, I.O., etc. Radiative transfer depends on the machine, but basically if the networking is good enough, like for example here, it can scale essentially perfectly as far as you can tell, at least the way we are doing it. Several things to note here and maybe to discuss later. It's very difficult to do scaling, first of all, because very often when you are applying for a proposal, you are asked, okay, so what is your scaling? And then you should say, okay, I can scale up to 20,000 cores, but they give you only 50,000 core hours, so you can't even run 20,000 cores, let alone scale 20,000 cores. So this kind of things is a little bit tricky, but also what is the standard? We saw many scaling plots already and none of them looked anything like the others, if you have noticed. So we need to probably some common standard to actually be able to tell, okay, what does mean good scaling and how do we compare one code to another, one computer to another, etc. And I don't think this is the case yet, as far as I can tell. So it's something to be discussed with you. What are the challenges? Starting with the N-body, which is relatively simpler. So first of all, numerical methods, there are many different ones. We're using P3M, particle-particle-particle mesh, but there are also tree codes and all sorts of other methods we saw already. And they are generally efficient and fairly well-developed. Most are highly parallel, so that's not really a huge problem. However, the problems are massive amounts of data. So one of these big simulations I'll show in a moment can easily be 10 terabytes per time slice or more. And this is just one time slice. If you have to save 100, then it gets into the petabytes. And then difficult to work with and basically impossible to store in any supercomputing center I have personally had experience with. So one of the solutions maybe is extensive on-the-fly post-processing. Many people already do that, and certainly we need to do this more because you just don't have a choice. Reliability and precision requirements are now very high. This we are talking about percentage level precision, so definitely we need to be able to do that, and Fraser will talk more about this a bit later. For example, against other codes or against some test that we know the answer to, etc. Scaling to very large sizes is tricky. The principles are very simple, relatively, for n-body codes, but practice much less so. Even utilizing currently available machines is not easy. I don't think anybody has run, for example, on a whole petascale machine n-body code, because it just, unless you do a trivial problem, like the mentioned ones this morning, for the Gordon Bell Prize, you just cannot do it. There are all sorts of things that come up. System libraries don't always scale well, and this is again a bit of a problem. We need more automated analysis pipelines, because if we are going to do on the fly or just after processing, then we need to basically run the code, run the pipeline, dump the data, and continue. Something like this, but this requires a lot more automation than we currently have, at least our group anyway. So here is one example of that Paul already showed this morning, so I won't go into much detail, but one of our bigger simulations, and currently we are running 500 megaparsecs with similar simulations, so this is essentially the Millennium simulations with 33 times the mass resolution, but we won't run it to ratio zero because that's probably impossible today. And you get huge number of halos, and basically the volume is comparable to the field of view of the EOR radio surveys like LOFAR. This means that you need about 5 by 5 degrees on the sky, and that's roughly what this is. At least the 500 megaparsec is almost exactly that. You can also do different scale simulations for different purposes. So another one that was mentioned this morning by Gustavo is the Jubilee project, where we were running 6 gigaparsec box, 6,000 cube particles. And the goal there is basically to study things that you just do not get with a smaller box, like very rare objects, half-rich statistics, etc. So in this kind of simulation, for example, you get more than a million clusters in one single simulation, so you have statistics basically all that you like. They are not hugely resolved, obviously, but still, you have them, you know their properties, clustering, you can do all sorts of things. And we are the main actually goal here is to calculate the ISW effect, which is shown here, and we had a paper recently which cross-correlates the ISW, calculates the ISW and cross-correlates with galaxies, which are also resolved in that, because it's big enough to resolve massive galaxies. And another thing that was mentioned, the halo catalogs, where are Gustavo's halo catalogs? Here they are, so everybody can use them, at least for this simulation, certainly for others as well. So if you are interested, feel free to use them, and we'll put some more when we have the data, obviously. So one of the results that came from these simulations, and by the way, much of this work was the PhD thesis of a student of mine who just finished, and is looking for jobs, so if anyone is interested in hiring a good person. Okay, so halo mass function, we calculated based on a large number of simulations, so that's probably unreadable, but these are the simulations going from redshifts of 0 to 26, and box sizes from very small to extremely large, the one that I showed. And what we found out is, first of all, halo mass function, if you do friends of friends algorithm for finding halo, is fairly universal. And you can also fit it and use it for all sorts of purposes. For spherical overdensity type halo finding, it's not universal. And you can start seeing, for example, the dark energy effects at late times and so on. But again, you can fit it both at high and low redshift, and we have all this data available. I don't know what that was. Okay. So what are the challenges in the radiative transfer area, the other bit which we are doing? First of all, the physics is more complex, and even if you do relatively straightforward radiative transfer, and there are more complicated versions as well, certainly computationally very expensive, and there are definitely needed approximation, because otherwise it can never work. It's, as was just mentioned, six-dimensional problem. And we can do six-dimensional problems in any way, pretty much, without approximations. It's very memory intensive, so basically there are a lot of arrays that you need to put in memory, so you can do only so much. And even more so when it's coupled directly with gas dynamics and gravity, so you cannot do very large problems unless you do it in a smart way. And then it's a very non-local problem, unlike, say, gas dynamics, which makes it more difficult. Gas dynamics is extremely local. Gravity is somewhere in between. It's local, but it's not too complicated, so you can still handle it. So you need domain decomposition, but it's very difficult because essentially you need to propagate information throughout the grid. And huge dynamic range is often needed because the characteristic scales of the patchiness for ionization are large, and as I'll show in a moment, but most physics are actually happening at very small scales, so you need to somehow connect the two, and one of the approaches is to have enough dynamic range, or at least account for it somehow at subgrid level. And the physics is very often quite simplified. Currently, the dynamic range is limited, so obviously larger simulations will help, larger machines will help if we can use them well. So here is one example that also Paul showed something similar. Essentially, why do we need large scales? Well, this is one of the current large simulations. These are our previous simulations, 163 megaparsecs, 600 megaparsecs, and this is the beam of LOFAR, roughly speaking. And what you can see here is basically that these they are H2 regions and neutral regions. The green is neutral, the yellow is ionized, that are basically of the same size as, almost the same size as this. So you cannot have this kind of simulation to simulate regions that are this big and are not typical for the universe. So essentially to get the patchiness, you need much larger scales in order to get the patchiness correctly. And here is a movie of the same thing. For some reason, it's not showing. Why is it not showing? Very strange. Okay, well, let's go back to try. And if not, then it doesn't work. Ah, now it's showing. Okay, so the dark dots are basically galaxies that appear. And then around them, the H2 region starts growing, and then you get this complicated patchy picture that comes out. So you see that you have these huge regions with no galaxies at all, and huge regions which are definitely many more galaxies than average, and this is much increased patchiness compared to much smaller volumes that typically are used on this kind of simulations. Another thing that one needs to take into account, physics is important, and that's one, just one example of it, which is so-called self-regulation or James mass filtering and flow mass sources that Paul was talking about. You see that the pictures are quite different between case with and without it, so you can have to take it into account. One example when resolution actually sometimes does not matter so much is because if you have small-scale structure and you average it over relatively coarse resolution like for LOFAR, you still see most of the structures. So in this case, actually, it doesn't matter as long as you get the physics correct at small scales. Okay, so speed up. One thing that I wanted to show is why do you need large volumes? Because ionization history only converges at volumes about a few hundred megaparsecs. If you have smaller volumes, even relatively large, like 50 megaparsecs, even ionization history is not converged. And if you do the same thing, for example, for stages of ionization, you get this huge range. Even for average regions, it's significant. And you cannot account for this in a small volume. Similarly, you get much larger patches, so this is one way to characterize the patches of ionization. And in a large box, you get much larger patches than in a small box. And whatever measure you use for that, you still see the same thing. Power spectra, you get more fluctuations in the large box as well, depending on the scale again. You get also non-convergence for small boxes. You get this range of factor of 2 or more, so you cannot use small boxes at all. And this is something else that I won't have time to talk about. Okay, so just to finish and have some points for discussion, because my time is almost done. Generic challenges, something that's not specific to M-body or radiative transfer or anything like this, and we need to somehow address it. Data storage and transfer rates, this was already mentioned. It's improving, but very much behind the simulation requirements. I can easily clock any machine whatsoever in no time at all. Basically, I can fill the disk instantly almost, which means that it's not enough, and it will probably never be enough, so we need to somehow go around this. One thing that wasn't mentioned, but it's hugely important as you go up in size and performance, fault tolerance. What happens if a node goes down, or what happens if the network is not reliable or something else? And this happens all the time. Basically, even on the current machines, it's disaster. Future machines will make it impossible unless we somehow have a solution for this. And I don't know what the solution is. I have some ideas, maybe. Efficient use of different architectures. This was mentioned, but we still need to think about it and maybe somehow automate it, because we don't want to think every time we have a new machine, let's do a new code. That's just not efficient.
No. Just summarize.
Okay. Well, I wanted to show the solutions for the questions.